Penguin Random House Audio presents What Wild Women Do, a novel by Karma Brown. Read for you by Hillary Huber and Karissa Vacker. To Judy and Bob, Mom and Dad, for gifting me, amongst many other wonderful things, a free-range, wilderness-filled childhood. Thanks to you, I learned to explore inside and out. I am a wild woman because of you. When women's lives are in stasis or filled with ennui, it is always time for the wildish woman to emerge. Clarissa Pinkola Estes, Women Who Run with the Wolves, Myths and Stories of the Wild Woman Archetype. Rowan, 2021. We came to the woods carrying both types of secrets, some self-protective and potentially destructive, others magnificent and transformative. Only time would tell what happened when those secrets were released and what became of us afterward. The price we pay for an external life not matching an internal one is steep, and for that lack of honesty, there are consequences, though often they aren't felt until later, and sometimes only after it's too late to change anything. It's fair to say things didn't turn out how we hoped. None of us is immune to catastrophe. However, there can be great beauty in what's left behind, if you're willing to riffle through the shards. March. It's pretty small, I say, before whispering, "What is that smell?" Seth takes a dramatic sniff of the air.
Boiled broccoli and something pine-like. Are you getting the same notes?
I pull back the bedroom window drapes and look into a parking lot. I miss California and the ocean, I say. And I do, enough that it's almost a physical pain. Wrapping my arms around myself, I hold on tight. Try to keep it together because there are far worse things than having to move back home and put your plans on hold. There are worse things, Rowan, I whisper, tracing the frost patterns on the window pane.
What's that?
Seth asks. He's on the other side of the bedroom, opening the side table drawer, being nosy. I shake my head. I think it's cabbage. When Seth gives me a confused look, I add, the smell? It's cooked cabbage. It's still cold here, and a recent light dusting of snow has left patches of white on the black asphalt of the complex's parking lot. Our old place in LA didn't exactly have a stellar view. It was mostly other buildings and side streets, but if you pressed yourself in just the right way against the wall and looked to the far right, you could catch a blue sliver of water. Technically, it was an ocean view. Seth sits on the bed, bouncing a few times, and waggles his eyebrows at me as the mattress squeaks and the headboard hits the wall behind it.
Plenty of give. This could be fun, right?
I wonder how many other people have had fun on that bed.
Good point, Seth says. Probably want to get a new mattress.
But we won't, because we can't afford it. He comes behind me and wraps an arm around my waist. With his other hand, he points out the window at a small cluster of trees edging the parking lot.
At least we have a hint of nature.
I lean my head against his chest and hold back tears.
Hey,
Seth says, turning me toward him and tucking a finger under my chin. He kisses the tip of my nose.
This is temporary. A few months, tops.
I nod. Temporary, I know. Seth pulls the drapes back farther, letting a wider swath of sunlight into the room.
And the light in here is good. Great, actually.
He grins at me.
That'll make filming easier.
I tense as filming is the last thing I want to think about right now. True, I reply quietly, without enthusiasm. But he doesn't seem to notice, has conveniently never noticed, or at least paid much attention to, my animosity toward his burgeoning YouTube channel, which has occupied much of his time and focus of late. Or maybe it's that I haven't explicitly told him how I feel, so he's innocently clueless versus purposefully ignorant. Either way, it's a sore spot between us, at least from my perspective. Seth Wright and I met in 2017 in LA. He was doing his MFA, I was finishing film school, and we moved in together after our third date, which remains one of the most spontaneous things I have ever done. While I eschew the love at first sight trope, it's hard for me to explain what happened with Seth any other way. We met at a party hosted by one of my classmates, Tate Alton, whose mother was a moderately famous actor and had a stunner of a beach house. Tate introduced us, and as I shook Seth's hand, I looked into his dark eyes, framed by the most incredible lashes I had ever seen, and my world flipped upside down. We drank too much sangria and sat on the beach in the dark, alternating between making out and testing each other on ridiculous feats of strength and endurance, like who could hold the longest handstand, me, and who could skip a rock the farthest into the ocean. Seth, though we really couldn't see well enough to be sure. Our second date was more traditional, with dinner at a restaurant and then a long beach walk where I held Seth's hand in one of mine and my sandals in the other. He was bright and refreshing, different from the other guys I'd met in LA, like a big squeeze of lemon juice in a glass of water. I was already smitten, but when he invited me to an escape room for our third date, all the clues leading to a key to his apartment and an earnest love letter written by hand, I couldn't imagine saying anything other than yes to his offer of moving in. Sure, my lease was up and it made good financial sense to have a roommate, but it was much simpler than any of that. I was head over heels in love. Times weren't easy for two creatives without secure jobs, but we hustled and limped along all right until the pandemic hit. Then I lost my server job and Seth his personal trainer one, and sooner than either of us expected, we ran out of money and prospects. With Hollywood shut down and no one looking at scripts, particularly from a writer with zero credits, I could no longer borrow against hope. Going home to Ann Arbor, where I grew up, seemed the best, or only, option. Despite the setback, we promised to continue chasing our dreams, me with my screenplay, Seth with his novel. But since leaving LA a few weeks ago, I've been stagnant, while Seth's motivation has grown, just not for his manuscript, which remains unopened. He's become single-minded about his nearly two-year-old YouTube channel, The Right Story, which started as a place to capture the daily struggles of an author trying to write the next great American novel. He read some article about how much money could be made on YouTube and became fixated on this solving our pandemic-induced financial woes. Initially, I didn't mind his shift in focus from author to YouTube content creator. I even did the odd video with him because, as he maintained, I was a big part of his story. Plus, between the grinding hustle to pay our bills and his frustrations with his unfinished book, it was nice to see him enthusiastic and excited about something again. No one was in a good mood in those days, as the pandemic raged on and life felt like one struggle after another, but Seth was particularly dark-minded. I'd call it more of a deep apathy than a depression, but it scared the hell out of me. My carefree, creative, and ambitious boyfriend, who had golden retriever-level positivity, became sullen and disconnected, at least until The Right Story took hold of him. I personally didn't get the appeal, either for creators or their audiences, but figured it was merely a happy distraction for Seth, a hobby until he got his feet back under him. I was wrong. As his growing number of subscribers asked for more couple-themed content, and our videos together performed better than his alone, I was soon participating in near-daily videos. We did day-in-the-life shoots of our morning routine, curated, naturally, journaling and stretching, followed by a breakfast of matcha lattes and poached eggs, all before 9 a.m. and the start of the workday. There were craft-related videos, with Seth showing off his color-coded manuscript system, embellished, as he only ever used yellow tabs, and even then not consistently, and me sharing tips for a screenplay's three-act structure. Sometimes we'd take the camera with us to the grocery store, for a healthy dinner video, or to the park to show how a bench and some monkey bars are all you need for a great workout. And very occasionally there would be a prank video. The most ridiculous.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.